Good news, we're back with another episode of Armchair Architects, the Azure Enablement series that's an ongoing conversation with Eric and Uli, two of the smartest architects I know. So last episode, we were talking about architecting mission-critical applications, and we thought we had the entire conversation, but then afterwards, we realized there's so much more to talk about, so this is a bonus episode. Join us as we continue the conversation about architecting mission-critical apps. Hey folks, welcome back to Armchair Architects as part of the Azure Enablement Show. Last time we were having this pretty intense conversation about mission critical apps, and I thought that we were gonna get into the land of chaos engineering, but then when we got off camera, we started having this conversation, we realized there was something mission critical that we hadn't actually talked about in that episode. And I don't wanna leave that out because I think it's really important to talk about. So Uli, take us back to that previous conversation and add the stuff that we left out, please.
Yeah, so in the beginning of the last episode, Eric mentioned something that a system is composed out of multiple parts, and the ideal situation is that the system will never fail while parts might fail in the solution. And I wanted to kind of draw the bridge to an architecture pattern that the community has embraced, which is called microservices. Microservices obviously is something that we are living and working, but we are generally associating those with smaller feature scope, faster and more agile delivery against a managed feature scope. But it's also a really great pattern to think about for mission critical applications or applications in general, to compose them into areas that are also have potentially different availability environments. And then you can utilize capabilities like fault domains and update domains. So a fault domain simply says, how many copies of that application do I run across failure zones? In Microsoft Data Center, for example, a failure zone is a rack because the top of rack switch has proven to be the most unreliable component in a compute environment. Again, that's being mitigated with multiple top of rack switches, but the concept of a fault domain still is there and is applicable. An update domain simply says, if I have five copies running, I can only take maximum two out at the same time and update them to this next version. And again, microservices allow us to really think about this in a end-to-end fashion and use the functional updates and potentially technical debt updates and so forth against this scope so that the system provides availability, but the individual component might have degraded performance because I'm taking one update domain out, which means I have only three copies left that can do the work. And I think putting it all together in mission critical solutions against availability, updates, fault domains, operational constraints, and so forth is really important as part of the thinking through how do you make your application highly available, because it's not a static thing. It is something that lives and breathes like all great applications do.
I find myself now wanting to be a devil's advocate here. I very much like microservices as a design pattern, but I'm also aware to hasten back to a previous episode that there is a change of complexity when I go to the land of microservices. And we were talking about simplicity. And so wouldn't a reasonable argument say you're increasing the complexity, the likelihood of it becoming better in some ways, because now it's a more complex architecture, can fail in so many different ways, and complex systems have latent failures all over the place. You know, there's a great paper by Dr. Richard Cook called "How Complex Systems Fail." So my question for you is, like, why is that okay? Why is it okay to introduce this complexity into a mission critical system? Because, you know, like, you could be introducing more failure modes.
Well, the way I would think about this, David, is the alternative is the monolith, right? Which many of us in the industry have grown up in. And we know that the monolith in and of itself is a monolithic piece of code that gets deployed as a unit, tested as a unit, regression tested as a unit, and managed as a unit, has significant drawbacks in terms of flexibility and accommodating for resiliency and failure. In a monolith, if there's a failure, likely the entire monolith application actually fails. In a microservices architecture, as we all know, there is the tolerance of transient failure among service components and the ability for us to inject abilities to accommodate for that failure. So while it is significant, I don't know if it's significantly, but it's a different level of complexity in terms of a microservice architecture. But I think for that complexity, what it buys you is governance around domain-specific elements of functionality that can fail if your application is architected in the right way versus the monolithic approach.
Yeah, and I also don't think that microservices necessarily means that there are hundreds of these things. I've seen solutions that are hundreds of microservices, but that doesn't have to be the case. You can also say, well, let's take a commerce application. So you have the commerce front end, which is 4 or 5 microservices, and then you have the commerce back end, which maybe is 10 microservices or 15 fulfillment services, those kind of things. And so you're having two systems that coordinate and cooperate together, ideally over a robust mechanism like a queue, where you effectively the front end system doesn't interact with the back end system directly. It simply puts requests on the on the queue, and it utilizes master data and cacheable data to effectively fulfill the requests. And if you do that kind of thing, you have two systems that work together. And because they are separated by a queuing mechanism, the applications can scale independently of each other, and they can also fail independently of each other. If the backend system is for some reason not available or not quite capable of keeping up with the demand, if you architect it right, the front end can still continue to accept orders while the backend is catching up. There is a certain breakover point if queue length gets too long and the backend system cannot keep up and there's more requests being poured in. At some point in time, you cannot recover anymore. But that's almost reading for another day. But those are things that I think you can do to utilize the concepts that we started with, which is independent updates, updates against a defined slice of functionality, while at the same time building an end-to-end system that composes then ultimately of, in our example, of 15, let's say, microservices, which sounds like a lot, but since we are partitioning them into systems, it's actually okay.
Well, and so I one of the things I'm hearing from you is how tightly coupled the systems are, have a direct impact on a mission critical system's ability to survive fault. And I think there's like a great set of books. I'm not going to say the person's name right. Harry Petrowski or something. There's a person who wrote about architecture. I have a bunch of his books that talk about like part of the reasons why certain disasters happen are because how tightly coupled their systems were. So that seems like an important design pattern to mention here. I'm super tempted now to, and this is not meant to be a gotcha, but is it correct to say that the design pattern you're suggesting is more expensive? Because we were talking about cost as well. I've just tried to get you on the simplicity versus complexity question.
Actually, in this case, let's take the commerce application where I have a commerce front end and I have a commerce back end. Because I'm separating them with a queue and I don't allow shared data updates, which is the complex one, like inventory, if you have to update the inventory all the time, that's expensive. I would argue that the system is ultimately cheaper, because I can scale the front end independent from the back end, and the queue acts as a buffer. And I can also scale the queue independent of the front end and the back end. And so therefore, I have three levers of how to manage cost and growth. And therefore, I should be able to manage ultimately a solution cheaper than if the front end had direct access to the back end and would effectively instantiate, let's say, objects in the worst case on the other side. That's as soon as a session object in the front end gets created, it would create something equivalent on the back end, which means the front end at the scale back end have to scale at the same level. And most of the time, the back end components like fulfillment, logistics, those kind of things are way more expensive to instantiate than front end components, which deal with users and so forth. It would be a bad idea to link these guys from a semantic model. So what you're doing is you're decoupling them, and that allows you to scale them independently and also make sure that the front-end components, which are quote-unquote cheaper to build than the back-end components, which are more process-heavy, are effectively not symmetric.
Yeah, arguably the monolith is always running. All of its components are humming, and there's only one level of capability. It's either on or off, right? And as Uli was saying, as you separate them, those high use components are optimized for cost and those get hit while the other potentially more expensive components are waiting idle until there's something for them to do. So in that case, they get spun up and do their jobs and then they kind of go to sleep.
Okay, so I want to head us back to what we promised for the upcoming episode, because I think that's where we're going next. But watch this segue. Eric, are microservices easier or harder to test?
It depends. We should talk about A/B testing, DevOps, Canary, all those different topics.
Do it. Start talking about it. Go for it, man.
So I think that there are more options, but with more options come more complexity unless you have a plan. So in this instance, for example, if you've got a microservice and it has maybe two or three dependencies on other microservices, you have options. You can test your component with a canary version of the target microservice, a test version of that microservice, a backwards or down level compatible version of that microservice, or a mock object in which you kind of determine, you run through some baseline tests. I think each one of those options are valid from an A/B testing perspective, but the focus is on what condition you're actually releasing for and what you're testing for. Coupled with a canary methodology in which you are releasing a version of your microservice, which you're A/B testing with other dependent versions of the microservice against a small group of real world users, the goal would be for you to be able to leverage this flexibility to the best capability that you have to release quality code and quality experiences.
Okay, so I just want to make sure I'm getting your canary reference. I usually think of canaries as you have two things, the new one and the old one. And one of the things that you're doing is you're peeling off some of the traffic, some of the incoming traffic towards your new one to test to see how it's going to do. And if it works great, you might add more traffic that way until eventually you've skewed all your traffic to the new. And if it doesn't work well, you're like, oh no. And you pull it back to the one that you previously had. That's what you mean by canarying, right? In this case?
Usually. Go ahead, Uli.
No, so that's generally how we use the canary. And it's really a replacement for user acceptance testing environments, because UATs are artificially trying to create traffic. That's most often the way it's done. Whereas a canary is actually a production environment. It might have a lower SLA, like what we do in Azure. We have a canary region that is a normal Azure region, just happens to be a lower SLA because all the changes that we make to the various Azure services go in there first before they get released into the broader Azure regions. And so from our perspective, it's a great way of replacing UAT with real production service while at the same time realizing that the changes you are testing haven't been tested against real production workloads before, so that you make sure that you manage the expectations of your users.
And it is largely a psychological experience, because as canary users, they want the latest features, but they're going to be more tolerant of disruptions in terms of quality and code. But at the same time, you get all the benefits that Uli talked about. It's a really authentic way to see how people interact with your system, albeit at a smaller scale, but still you have the opportunity for people that are going to be more friendly to your system to report bugs and to help you improve the quality before you take it into the general release cycle.
And that presumes an obvious explicit sort of beta situation or A/B testing where the people that are in that group are aware that they are the canary. Sometimes you canary production systems without people knowing that they're on the new version. But this leads us, of course, to our original topic, which is one way. Oh, looks like, Uli, you have something to say. I want to make sure.
Yeah, so I want to bring it back. No, I want to bring it back to the microservices conversation we just had. If you think about the way user acceptance testing works, it's not necessarily monolithic from a technology perspective, but it's a monolithic from a testing perspective. You waterfall all changes through and you reach certain stages: dev, test, user acceptance, pre-prod, production. Now, in this new world, when we are using microservices as our way to deliver these things, you don't necessarily want to create this kind of waterfall. You want to have the services roll into production on their own schedule based upon user demand, capability, is it ready, and so forth. And therefore, a canary-based model, a ring-based model is what we call it. Ring zero is our canary, ring one is the next production region, and so forth. is much faster because Azure is composed out of 400, 450 services or something like that. And we are not having a schedule that says all 450 services on May 1st, you have to be here. We let each service do their thing and we use the canary method and the ring methodology to effectively make sure that the quality is as it needs to be for each individual service. And therefore, we don't need, and we cannot really do user acceptance testing in the classic sense. And so for me, if you're really serious about microservices, you should think about canary testing and ring-based deployment models as part of your methodology to move forward with respect to delivering software in this way.
Okay, so I'm gonna unleash the segue again because I think that the next step up from this for trying to understand what could happen in production might be the land of chaos engineering. And I'm hoping that we can come back, we'll come back to that. And I thank everyone for being patient to allow us to talk about this part, but we wanted to make sure that we were saying what needed to be said about mission critical stuff. So I wanna thank Uli and Eric for this episode. I wanna thank you all for watching this. And I really hope for reals this time, you'll join us to talk about chaos engineering on the Azure Enablement Show.